Hello, and welcome to a special edition of Inside Culture. This time, I'm linking up with Lagos in Nigeria to speak with writer, feminist, and part-time fashion icon, Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. She's attracted a generation of global readers to African literature, spoken out for women across the world, and has become more than a merely literary celebrity. Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie is one of the greatest living writers, celebrated across the world. Her novels, set in both Nigeria and the United States, between which Adichie splits her time, reflect a diverse range of African stories. In 2007, her most famous book, Half of a Yellow Sun, won what is now the Women's Prize for Fiction, and was later voted the winner of winners in a public vote. It's set against the devastating backdrop of the Biafran War, the Nigerian civil war of the late 60s, which took a terrible toll on her own family. But Chimamanda's made headlines for more than just her literary prowess.
Yes, there's a problem with gender as it is today, and we must fix it. We must do better.
In 2012, her TED talk, We Should All Be Feminists, went viral and was sampled by Beyoncé.
We raise girls to see each other as competitors, not for jobs or for accomplishments, which I think can be a good thing, but for
and on t-shirts by Dior.
We teach girls that they cannot be sexual.
The essay based on it has sold around the world. Swedish government even gave a copy to every 16-year-old in the country. But her latest book, Notes on Grief, shows a different side of Adichie. It's a moving account of the loss of her father, James, who died last year, and her own reactions to that. Tragically, since the book's publication, Chimamanda has also lost her mother, Grace. And she's speaking to me in her first interview since then.
Grief is a cruel kind of education. You learn how ungentle mourning can be, how full of anger. You learn how glib condolences can feel. You learn how much grief is about language, the failure of language, and the grasping for language. Why are my sides so sore and achy? It's from crying, I'm told. I did not know that we cry with our muscles.
Chimamanda, thank you very much. It's such a pleasure to meet up, even if it is by Zoom. And I wanted to start with your recent book, because I think that anybody who's lost a parent or lost someone very close to them recognises the sort of unspeakability of grief. Who were you writing it for, or what were you writing it for?
I wish I knew the answer to that, Mary. I started writing it a few days after my father died. And my father dying really was the most... nothing has ever left me as shaken as my father dying. And I just turned to writing, and I hope that other people who are grieving might find in that essay a kind of, comfort.
I mean, what struck me very much about it, and, you know, it's 25 years since I lost my parents, and yet you still have some kind of memory about what that destabilization was like. What I found very, very, very striking about it was kind of real attempt to analyse the kind of unsayability of it all. So, I mean, you end up at the very end of the essay saying that your father was now in the past tense. It was. And there's this kind of, this linguistic division that the dead cross that is very, very hard for the living.
You know what, I just really love how you put it, the unsayability, because I think it's really what it felt like to me. And I think that for me, the tenses represented a kind of finality that I was so unwilling to accept. Yeah. Even hearing you say that sort of crossover that the dead have to do, I still, something in me, my spirit still bristles hearing it, because I want to tell you, no, you're wrong, you know?
Messages pour in, and I look at them as through a mist. Who is this message for? On the loss of your father, one says. Whose father? My sister forwards a message from her friend that says my father was humble despite his accomplishments. My fingers start to tremble and I push my phone away. He was not. He is.
You've had a particularly terrible, terrible year of bereavement because, I mean, not only to your father, but then on his first birthday after his death, your mother died. And, I mean, you're wearing a great T-shirt there saying A Beautiful Life with a picture of your mother, which is very moving. And, you know, how did that pile on of bereavement, I mean, how did you manage to see through that?
I haven't. I mean, actually, this conversation is the first time that I'm doing anything sort of public since my mother died. One of the things I've realized about this period of grieving is how much cliches come alive. I really do feel like I'm in a dream. My heart really is heavy, you know, in a literal way. And I've come to respect cliches because I think, you know, I don't have any new language to talk about this. I'm told it will take time, and I'm reading about the so-called stages of grief. I think this is so wrong because it's not that tidy.
Yeah, you know, and literature helps in some ways rather more than the sociology of grief, I think.
You know, I wish I had known this earlier because I've just gone back. I'm just reading the books I love.
Yeah.
You know, I'm reading Mary Oliver's poems, and there's just something about just the language of it. And they're not necessarily about grief, but it's just, I think, reminding me of the things that I love. And maybe I need to be reminded of those things now.
Yeah. Everything you've ever written about your parents and the films that you see, you know, when you're speaking in the States and things like that, you can see that your parents were so proud of you. When did you start to write, and what kind of role did they have in it?
They kind of gave their children room to be. It might not sound remarkable, but it was for their time and place, because I think there's a certain kind of conservative element in Nigerian child raising. And so I grew up loving books, being encouraged to read. I was a bit of a strange child, I'm told. And I was allowed to be a strange child. And I think that allowing made my writing possible. I started writing really young. My mother would keep the stories I wrote. So I remember when I was maybe about 8 or 9, there was a pile of my little bits of scribbles in her room, on her dressing table. My mother was very beautiful and very sort of glamorous. So her dressing table had things that I loved to go play with, her jewelry, her makeup. And then next to that was a pile of my, you know, little bits of paper where I wrote stories and I would draw pictures. And as I got older, my father also sort of allowed me to read books that weren't really the sort of books I should be reading. So when I was 11, I was reading books like A History of the Roman Catholic Church, which was from my father's study, and to him this was fine.
You've said that you read very English children's stories. Can you say a bit about that?
But I think that was very much the norm for every middle-class child in Nigeria, because we grew up reading the books that were available, and the books that were available were mostly books that had been brought from England. And
can you remember, like Enid Blyton or?
Enid Blyton, I adored. I think I read everything. Apparently, she is now considered a bit politically incorrect. But when you're a child, you're just swept up in the stories. I loved them. And then when I started to write, I was really just aping Enid Blyton. So my characters in my early stories were really sort of mini Famous Five characters. They went and explored things in dungeons, even though I had really no idea what the hell a dungeon was. And they had cucumber sandwiches. And I remember even then thinking, this doesn't sound very appetizing. Why would anybody make a sandwich with cucumbers? I mean, I like to joke about it now, but really, I think it said something about how important it is for young people to see themselves reflected in the books they read, and how important it is to have a wide range of reading materials for children.
When did you get those?
I'm going to say maybe 13, 14. When I really started to read this wonderful series called the African Writers Series. And it had books by writers from all over the continent. And that's actually, I think, how I started to have a sense of Africa, right? Because until then, I really didn't. Reading Chinua Achebe's novel, Arrow of God, is what I think gave me a certain kind of confidence, because he was writing about Igbo land in the 1910s, 1920s, which to me was just so exotic. But at the same time, it felt kind of familiar. And so I thought, I can do this, but for my own time, if that makes sense.
Hi, little guy. The cashier was large and cheerful, her cheeks reddened and peeling from sunburn. Helping mommy out? DK Puribak, Auntie Uju said, with the nasal sliding accent she put on when she spoke to white Americans, in the presence of white Americans, in the hearing of white Americans. Purit Bak. And with the accent emerged a new persona, apologetic and self-abasing.
When you talk about the kind of reading that you were doing when you were a child, you see those kind of different registers, different languages, different perspectives actually embedded in what you're writing now. And there is a brilliant expertise that you have at code switching. I mean, you can talk and write American. You can talk and write middle-class Nigerian. I mean, do you think that does go back to those kind of different traditions of storytelling that you had as a kid?
I think that to be Nigerian is to automatically be in a space where code switching in some ways is a necessity. And so in my sort of Nigerian life, I go from speaking my educated middle-class Nigerian English to speaking, when I go to the market, what is this one now? Why would you not give me this one for this price? And then I go to speaking pidgin English. Why you no one come now? So there are different circumstances in your lives where you have to, you become these versions of yourself. And then having lived in the US, when I went to the US, I made myself sound American because I felt I needed to do that to survive America. Now it's quite difficult for me, but apparently I'm told I was very convincing in my American self years ago when I would say, can I have some water, please? And now I don't do it very well.
You're still but convincing.
And it's all really automatic. One doesn't really think about those things. And so I try to capture that when I write my fiction.
But I wondered if you thought of that sort of code switching as actually quite empowering, you know, that ability to operate within different social and cultural worlds inside or outside Nigeria or the US. Is it fun?
Is it fun? I think so, sometimes. I mean, I like to tease my friends who are Europeans or Americans, and I say to them, I know much more about your world than you know about mine. And even though my world is sort of the world that's not at the center economically and politically, this gives me a certain power because I understand your nuances, and my nuances are completely non-existent to you. And so when I'm in Europe, I like to sort of poke at what I call European tribalisms, because I say, Africa is often talked about in terms of tribe and tribalism, and people forget. And so for me as an African, when I'm in Europe, I think, my God, this is tribalism. You know, I think if you sort of brush aside that shiny patina of the European Union, I mean, there's just so much. And I love it. I love it. And I think the reason I recognize it is that it's familiar to me.
Yes.
The politics of Nigeria underlies Chimamanda's prize-winning novel, Half of a Yellow Sun. It takes place during the Nigerian Civil War, in which huge numbers of Igbo people were killed fighting for the Republic of Biafra. The book has personal origins for Chimamanda, but has found readers around the world.
I think I write for people who love to read the kinds of books that I love to read. And I think that's a very broad group, so. But in general, my writing is such a personal, intense, intuitive process. And Half of a Yellow Sun in particular was very emotional for me because I was writing the story of my family. You know, both my grandfathers died in that war. It really deeply changed my family's trajectory. And so writing it for me was really just so personal. And so when it did well, I was so pleased and surprised. But I just didn't expect it. And I continue to be surprised by how it touches people. And I like to think that maybe people who love to read can recognize something, you know, sort of true, right? Because I wasn't performing for anyone. I was really just writing. I was writing with my, I know, here's another cliche, Mary. I was writing with my heart.
Yeah, cliche, but true. In some ways, you were already thinking about what grief did to people when you wrote that.
Yes.
And your own absolutely visceral, yes, personal grief that is embedded and inscribed in Notes on Grief, it's already, you can see the seeds of what you're wanting to say in Half a Yellow Sun.
Yeah, I think that's so well observed. Yes, I think that's very true.
About a quarter of her class attended school. She taught them about the Biafran flag. They sat on wooden planks, and the weak morning sun streamed into the roofless class as she unfurled Odenigbo's cloth flag and told them what the symbols meant. Red was the blood of the siblings massacred in the north. Black was for mourning them. Green was for the prosperity Biafra would have. And finally, the half of a yellow sun stood for the glorious future.
You've taken a very kind of, to me, very noble stand against kind of single issue outrage culture. Mm. I mean, what do you feel about this? I kind of sense that there is a very, there are very hard-line views about what's right and wrong, which particularly on social media, but elsewhere.
Yeah, I mean, social media, it's just given rise to a very shallow, hollow outrage culture. I think we need to recognize we're flawed, right?
Yeah.
And
yeah,
we really are. And I think in some ways it's the essence of literature and storytelling, that flawedness of human nature. And I feel as though right now, with social media, there's a kind of performance is really what is important. I'm told that young people will, so somebody says something that's somehow outside of the accepted orthodoxy, and suddenly that person's friends are all being asked to denounce that person. And I'm thinking, but whatever happened to, you know, just basic old-fashioned ideas of, you're my friend, I'm going to stand by you. You know, yeah, loyalty. I'm going to have a bit of compassion for, yeah, you. I'm going to think you were maybe just having a bad, you know,
having a bad
it's
day.
Just become, yeah. Yeah. Yes, you know, yes, one is allowed to have a bad day. There's a hardness, yeah, in the culture that social media has created about how we talk about political things, social things. And it worries me because I just find it to be lacking in compassion. And also, you know, I find it quite uninteresting.
And I've been really struck in what I've read about how you manage to empathise with all sorts of different sides. And I recently read your short story, which came out in 2016, which was set around the figure of Melania Trump, Donald's wife. And you didn't come down exactly on her side, but what you did do was kind of had a sympathetic look at her life in that awful gilded cage.
I think when I wrote that story, it was partly wanting to kind of humanize her, you know, because and I think even to the end, she wasn't really, I felt, a human person. She was just a kind of, I think people projected on her what they wanted to. And I did wonder about what her life was like. So I did quite a bit of reading.
I think that what's really interesting about your interventions in the public sphere is that you set out not to demonise, but to persuade. Mm. And it struck me that, when the Swedish government decided to send your book on feminism to schools for 16-year-olds across, they got it right, really, because you were setting out to talk to them in ways that wasn't about academic theory, it wasn't about the theory of gender, it was about how do we feel as women and as people now.
Yeah, and because I'm a storyteller, I'm always thinking about these things in terms of stories and human beings. I'm so angry about so much in the way that the world deals with women. And what I'm thinking about is how can we fix it? So I've done stupid things like have a woman come up to me at the airport and say, my husband is so difficult, he doesn't understand. And I said to her, let's call him. I did that. I quite like a very good academic argument. But in general, what I want is to try and change things, even if it means just a tiny change. So I'm thinking if a young woman or a young man reads this, will they change ever so slightly what they think and therefore how they interact with the world? Really, that's it for me when it comes to feminism.
Yeah.
We spend too much time teaching girls to worry about what boys think of them. But the reverse is not the case. We don't teach boys to care about being likable. We spend too much time telling girls that they cannot be angry or aggressive or tough, which is bad enough. But then we turn around and praise men for the same reasons.
I mean, I think the feeling you get from, from that first little book is that you're talking to me. You're not lecturing me, you're not theorising me, you're not telling me I'm stupid, you're sort of telling me some things I half know already, but enabling me to think them.
To be a woman and to live in the world, you kind of already know what feminism is. And so I think maybe, if anything, it's just giving the language or making women think, yes, that's what I'm thinking. I think privilege, in the sense that men in the world have privilege in ways that women don't, can blind you. Yeah. And often, it's not that men are evil, some are. I was going to name a public figure, but I thought I'd better be well-behaved today. But it's that men are blinded by privilege. I mean, there are men who are shocked when they're told about how often rapes occur. Yeah. There are men who are shocked when they're told that women are constantly belittled in big ways and small ways in everyday life, because they don't see it.
No.
I've earned a right to talk about privilege because there are ways in which I don't have privilege and ways in which I do. And so as a woman, obviously, I don't. As a black person in the Western world, I don't. But as a person who's educated, I do. Yeah. So there's a certain level of class privilege that I recognise, I have come to recognise, blinds me. I didn't always.
Yeah. But one thing that I have to say has happened, I mean, you have become, a fashion icon. You're on the cover of magazines. You get sampled by Beyonce. You're there. Iconically. Now, did that surprise you? Is it a real bore sometimes? I mean,
yes, I mean, it still surprises me. And, you know, I have a very healthy, well-polished sense of vanity. And so I made the choice to talk about fashion, right? And that I love. But I think being a public figure comes with, you know, that there's a lovely quote by Rilke that fame is the sum of misunderstandings around a person. And it's that feeling of often being misunderstood, sometimes deliberately so.
Yeah.
And then there's also a kind of self-imposed pressure where I think, you know, if all of these people are looking up to me, my God, I better bloody get it right.
It's a long way to fall, you know?
Yes.
I mean, there's a wonderful ancient philosopher who's talking about flattery, which in some ways is on the same spectrum as fame and celebrity.
So yes.
Flattery is very interesting. Because it's only the person to whom it is directed who knows it's not true. I think to some extent celebrity goes along with that, that, you know, you look at yourself and you think, me? With all my failings, flaws, irritations?
But I think there's also a part of me that, and this might have something to do with the way that I was raised, which is, I don't really fall for the bullshit. I mean, I can tell when a person hasn't read me and is saying, oh, I love your work. I can tell. For me, the most moving thing, really, is just feeling that I've touched another human being, that something I wrote or said really meant something to somebody. That always makes my day, always.
Yeah, yeah. And that's how you're bringing up your daughter.
Yes, I'm... Actually, she's also not terribly impressed by her mother. She just sort of rolls her eyes when people want to take pictures with me, and she just thinks this is such a bore and a waste of time. And so I think that's also good for me.
And one last question. What is there still for Chimamanda to do? What do you want to do, you know, that you haven't done already? What do you want to write that you haven't written already?
Oh, there's so much I want to write, Mary, so much. I want to write more history. I want to write pre-colonial Igbo history. I want to write about women in particular in pre-colonial Igbo land. I want to write about... I want to do... I can't tell you because I'm superstitious. But there's so much more I want to do.
Anyway, it's been absolutely great to talk to you, and I'm really, really grateful for you making the time. So, thank you very much, Chimamanda.
Thank you.
Thank you again to Chimamanda. And that's all from me for this series. But we do still have another episode up our sleeves, because next week I'm handing over the Inside Culture reins to Shahida Bari, who'll be exploring self-expression, how we reveal ourselves to the world through the clothes we wear and the art we create. I'll be watching and hope you will too. But to finish now, back to Chimamanda herself, reading from her book, Notes on Grief.
It does not matter whether I want to be changed, because I am changed. A new voice is pushing itself out of my writing. Full of closeness, I feel to death, the awareness of my own mortality. So finely threaded, so acute. A new urgency, an impermanence in the air. I must write everything now, because who knows how long I have.